Ms. Galloway?
Present.
Ms. Van Buren?
Present.
Mr. Kincaid?
Present. All right, Council, stand for pledge allegiance and Councilman.
All eyes.
Pledge allegiance.
To the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. President, I want to see if I can get along the side, first of all, for Mr. Rock, Reverend Rock, son. And then I also want to do a moment of silence for Eric Dark, Michael Brown, as it relates to what's going on around the nation. When we do that moment of silence, I'm gonna hold my breath as I can't breathe, and I'm gonna hold my hands up as the don't shoot. So I would like to request a moment of silence for those that just came.
Thank you.
Great.
All right, next item on the agenda is the minutes that were provided in our package or motion. Accept, been moved, supported, and supported. Is there any discussion on the minutes?
Yes. Yes, sir. So it's been moved and supported.
It's been supported, we're discussing.
I would do a amendment to the motion to move and support our amendment motion with correction. And then I would proceed to the correction.
Just a second, Councilman. All right, we're just gonna have to plug it in. Go ahead.
So I would offer an amendment to the motion to accept the minutes with corrections, and then I would point out some of the corrections.
There's a substitute motion on the floor to move with corrections. Is there support? Is there support?
Support.
Been moved and supported. Councilman Mays, will you do specific corrections?
Specifically, in the organization of city council, it said that Councilman Mays made a motion supported by Councilman Wyatt Davis, and the motion was denied. That's not accurate. I would want that minutes to reflect that the motion was not denied. The motion was ruled out of order as Ms. Brown talked to the city attorney. You know, I disagreed with him, so I don't want him to
mischaracterizing the minutes on both of those, correct? You want to change how things are recorded in the minutes for items placed on file, and you want the minutes to reflect that you made a referral to go to legislative affairs. Is there any other changes? Okay. Need a roll call.
Ms. Poplar?
Yes.
Mr. Alden?
Yes.
Mr. Freeman?
Yes.
Mr. Davis? Mr. Neely?
Yes.
Ms. Galloway?
Yes.
Ms. Van Buren?
Yes.
Mr. Kincaid?
Yes.
Mr. Mays?
Yes.
Motion carries nine nothing. All right, next item on our agenda are two special orders. The first of which is Drain Commissioner Jeff Wright has included to the mayor an update on the Fair 90. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good evening to the council. It's been a couple of months since we were here last, and I thought we would come in tonight and give you a status report on the KWA pipeline and construction thereof. And a couple other items, for instance, to remind the council that Councilman Sheldon Neely, Councilman Josh Freeman, and Mayor Walling all sat on the KWA board, which the last time I met was about 2 months ago. One of the things that I thought was important tonight was to actually bring you up to status on where we are with construction, because a lot's been done, and I don't believe a lot of people are aware of it. So, if you would, my assistant over here is going to have to put the electronic gizmos for me. So, one of the things that we talked about last time I was here, when we were debating the KWA, was the fact that our former supplier of water said that our estimated numbers to build this pipeline were under counted, so to speak. They felt that it would cost us at least $360 million to build this pipeline, and now we have taken all the bids for all the contracts related to this pipeline, and as you can see, it even came in below our own estimate. Our estimate was $312 million. The total construction cost by bid came in at $233 million. Several of the companies that you'll see in the following PowerPoint are local companies, E&L, which is located in Flint, and several others. And I think you're all aware that since we've taken all these bids, one of the pipe manufacturing companies, American Cast Iron and Pipe, has also built a new facility at the Buick City site, and they plan on starting production of pipe there in the very, very near future. I also point out the interest bid. You see four lines down the bond interest. We had estimated 5% the last time we had talked to the council. And the actual bid interest came in at 4.72%. Now that 28 basis points doesn't sound like a lot, but that equates to almost $30 million less in interest paid over the next 30 years. So we got a great interest rate. The way we structured the bond, actually we won an award for the best bond sale of the year by Bond Buyer Magazine out of New York. And with that, if anybody wants to see why we won the award, there's a 2-minute presentation online at the Bond Buyer Magazine. It gives some of the details as to why they gave this project the award over the several hundred projects around the country or around the Midwest that were involved with that process. I still can't get over myself the great prices that we got from the contractors. Currently, there are almost 900 men and women from Flint and Genesee County who are here working on this project. That will peak at around 1,100 people next spring, and that will go on for the next 24 months or so. I really am glad that E&L, Zito, and D.I.S.D. are pulling workers from Flint and Genesee County right and left. position to bring new business here in the long term, some of which I'll talk about at the end of this presentation. That was the groundbreaking ceremony at the intake pipe. Those were the five core board members. That is on Lake Huron. To give you a perspective on the size of the pipe that we put in the ground, that's me standing inside of it. That's an 84-inch diameter. That pipe actually went out a mile and a half underneath Lake Huron. That pipe is installed. This is the bore pit that that pipe was pushed out under the lake from. That white ring in the bottom is the same diameter as the pipe that I was standing in. And it basically 52 feet in the ground. They set that pipe in that cradle, and a hydraulic system pushes it out underneath the lake. That's the actual drill bit that drilled the soils out underneath the lake. It's called a tunnel boring machine. I think we've got a couple more pictures of it, but interestingly, this is it being extracted from the ground, the same machine, because we pushed both ways from that pit. One went out underneath the lake, and one went to where the pump station is being built on the land side of the lake. And that's them taking the tunnel boring machine out of where it was in. This is the, go back a little, please. This is one of the excavators on one of the barges. We had two barges out of the lake. The two largest barges on the Great Lakes currently, and a lot of the work that you'll see as we go on was done from those barges to complete the intake portion of this pipe. That particular excavator has a 100-foot boom on it, which is extremely long for an excavator. And this is some of the equipment we're moving around on the site. Go ahead. This is that same tunnel boring machine being retrieved from the bottom of Lake Huron. There's a barge crew, and you're going to, in a moment here, see a picture of the diver that also assisted in this. But that's the same machine. That's the diver. That's the same machine that you saw being taken up out of the ground. And that's where it ended up in Lake Huron, and that's near where the intake pipe will be for all our drinking water. If I was a younger person, I would certainly consider going to dive school. That young man, whether he's in the water or on the barge, gets $600 an hour to do that work. So if you had young people, encourage them to learn how to do deep sea diving. That's all I can say. And he's not walking on water. That's the same young man, I believe, and he just happened to get his picture taken just as he was getting out of here, so it does give that illusion. This is that excavator putting some of the stone on the bottom of the channel that the pipe sets in. This is a piston shot from one barge to the other. One barge is used to physically do the work. The other barge is used to stockpile and store material. Again, working in action. Go ahead. Clamshell bucket again, where they put the intake has to be excavated out and just to use it. Again, they've done the next story, they're doing the final feet of work for global level, and that's what will also pump water directly to the city of Flint's water treatment plant. Another shot of that. This is the intermediate.
No, we're still on.
No, this is still the lake pump station, excuse me, another name. Again, the lake pump station. Some of the contractors and union, building trade union people work on it, but this is what they call the cricket. As you can see, that crane sitting next to it, there's a person inside that crane giving some scale as to the size of that cricket. It's almost like Lincoln logs. Those logs are 40 feet long by 16 inches thick by 12 inches, actually 12 inches by 16 inches thick. That wood structure sits over the top of the intake, and it's called cribbing, and it is used to protect that intake from ice, from wandering ships, boats, etc. That sits in the center of the cribbing, that sits over the pipe, and then the cribbing sits over the top of that. That's being set from the barge. This is the intermediate pump station site in Lynn Township. This is excavating to get it started. This is the actual waterline pipe that American Cast Iron manufactures being installed at that site. This is another angle of them bringing the concrete out of the, I think this was about 38 feet in the ground. And again, as the concrete cures, they pour the next level and continue to bring it up out of the ground. Another angle of that. Another angle of that. The interior. Some more work there. This particular pump station is being built by E&L Construction, which is located in Flint, Michigan. Used to be called Erickson Lindstrom. Been around the city of Flint for almost 70 years. This is where we're actually laying some of the pipe. This is the pipe that actually goes to the city of Flint water treatment facility. Another local contractor, Zito Construction, was the low bidder on this one. This is some of the pipe being delivered to the site on Stanley Road. Surveyors. This is one of the man ways that are located on top of that pipe where they set valves, the blow off systems, those types of things. Same construction, same area. Same construction. That particular pipe is used for boring. Instead of doing open ditch construction, they actually push that underground with an auger and then put the pipe inside it without disturbing the surface. Another shot of that particular area, another one. Setting a fire hydrant. Setting a manhole. One of the things that I want to remind the council of is the support that we received from a lot of entities during the discussions on this project, one being the Michigan Agribusiness Association. And Jim Byron, who heads that association, is like the site selector for companies that want to locate in the state of Michigan. This gentleman directs them to where he believes the best place for their business is, in Michigan. He's very big in food processing, agribusiness, taking raw product, turning it into a food product, turning it into a packaged product, and distributing it. He believes, as I do, and I'm sure many in this room do, that the New York City site is the best site in the state of Michigan for these types of activities. To that end, there are already businesses from the southwest of this country looking at this state and other states around the Great Lakes. What Mr. Byron believes, along with many good things that we have to offer, but he believes this pipeline and the water that it can bring to the Buick City site makes the Buick City site the best place in the state to relocate these types of businesses. As I said, there are many businesses that live in parts of this country or work in parts of this country where the water supply is not the best, where getting water can be difficult as the droughts continue, and they're looking at our area. And I encourage everybody in this room and across the street to work with these companies as they come around, because we have real potential to bring these businesses to Flint, Michigan. Some of them, to give you an example, those little red trays, those are all tomato plants. I don't know how many of you shop at Meyer's 50 Acres, but all the tomatoes that are sold at Meyer's 50 Acres are built, or excuse me, grown in that facility. It's a giant greenhouse. It's in the state of Michigan. So when you buy a tomato from Meyer's, it's not imported, it's grown right here in the state, and this pipeline gives us a big potential to do real similar type of activities. It also opens the door for green technologies. Everything, as we've talked about in the past, from solar conductor material, which takes almost 1,500 gallons of water to produce a couple cubic feet of that material, to algae-produced energy, hydrogen power that comes from water, etc. And I've already mentioned American Cast Iron. I think that they are going to do great things for fun. I hope they expand. And what they also do is they show other businesses that, hey, Flint, Michigan is a great place to do work. Between 69 and 75, the rail, our educational institutions, the water, the power, and on and on and on. This is a great place to bring your jobs. That's this picture of the new facility that they built there. Some of the stockpile pipe that go into this project. Have you got any videos? I got two little short videos that I'd like to show you. One is the launching of that wooden crib, and one is kind of like a composite of several different aspects of this. This is the crib. They launched it like a boat when it's ready to go. It actually has some audio. So that will be floated out to the site and lowered on the intake portion. There's two of those. Go ahead and show me that one here. This is a composite of different things that took place out on the site this last summer. appreciate your time this evening, and I would only say again, I'm glad that the president would like me to take questions. I'd only say again that the solution to much of what we all face is jobs. This project not only brings us jobs on the short term, it has the real potential to bring us jobs long term in many related and unrelated fields. It'll be up to us, all of us, to encourage those businesses to locate here and to be satisfied with working here. It can be done, and I believe it will be. So with that, I'll be glad to answer any questions.
Thank you, Sheriff. We have some specific questions to the project.
Mr. President, I don't, but I just wanted to say to Mr. Wright, publicly, my condolences to your mom. I'm glad that the moment is silent, but specifically and in general, I enjoyed the presentation.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else, Councilman Davis?
Back. Yeah, I came in a little late, but this is a question I wanted to ask since we already have you in front. What happened to DEQ said in regards to the grounds and the new site? I know that there was some questions in regarding the contamination at that site. What have the DEQ, what have they actually said about that? Did they cover it up, or is it conducive for us to do that there at that site? I just want to know for myself and some of my constituents want to know that as well.
And actually, might be a better question for our people.
Well, I can talk about it in general, okay, Mr. President. In general, we all know that our grounds fields, whether they were the Buick site, the old Chevy Noble, or the Delphi sites, and AC spark plugs out on Dorn Highway, since they were built 100 years or so ago, that there's been contamination on those sites. The EPA and the DEQ have decided, and I agree, that the best way to contain and control those contaminants are just keep those sites capped with the concrete asphalt that's already there. So any business, including American, the critical part is to keep the site capped, and that's what they've done. And any future businesses would also have to keep those sites capped.
Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I'll just go down the line. Councilman Popper.
Thank you, Mr. President. Jeff, I just want to thank you so very much for the vision that you had along with the county and with the city of Flint to bring this to life. This is a vision, and Proverbs tells us where there is a vision, the people will perish. I want to also thank you for bringing this presentation, because a lot of us may not be able to get out to the work site to know what is going on, and this presentation was just awesome, and I want to thank you for that. And maybe for the year 2015, if you could put it on your plate, you might want to do a community forum using these videos to let the people in the city, in our wards and around the city, keep them abreast on what but I just want to thank you and thank the company that went and took the time to look at Buick City, go to Buick City, put their plant there, and create some jobs for the city. So I tell everybody every day, we're about to inch more and we're going to inch along. And this is just a part of that puzzle that's coming together. So I just want to thank you so very much.
I thank you, and we will come spring be glad. And I think it's appropriate to give some presentations to community centers and our churches, and we'll make sure we get that scheduled in.
My sentiments as well. I want to thank you for the leadership on moving this project forward, and I can personally attest, I was out on was done about 4 or 5 years ago, where we had a site, something called LNAP. And LNAP was nothing more than the whole hydraulic fluid, gasoline, and other things that may be in the ground. But there are some processes in place that the EPA has been working with over the last few years. And one of the things that I would implore my colleagues, because I'll be transitioning away, is to reach out to the Racing Trust Group. Because they are the people that actually have control of the site. Yes. And they'll be more than willing to come in and give you an update and talk to you about some of the things that are moving forward and possibly some of the potential folks that are interested in the site. So that's one thing that I definitely would suggest to my colleagues, because you know I won't be here after this month. Thank you.
Councilman
if I may, I didn't give you a timeline. Our goal, our stated goal was to have Lake Huron Water to the City of Flint Water Treatment Plant by June of 2016, a little over a year and a half from now. The county still won't be hooked to the system and ready to go until late 2016, so the City of Flint will get the water first from the lake. It's going to be another 6 months or so before the county's facilities are ready. And that's because the City of Flint has an existing plant. It's totally a great plant to use, and all we've got to do is get this pipe to you. And that's been a priority from day one, and that's one of the reasons why we'll get water to Flint a little quicker than we actually will.
Yes, you already answered some of my questions talking about the completion, which I think is fantastic. So would you consider that we are right on schedule or ahead of schedule as to the progress that's been made?
It's a good question. Right now, we're right on schedule where we're able to be at this point in time with the pipeline itself. And if we have a mild winter, we may even be able to move a little ahead of that schedule. If we have a winter like we did last year, it might move it down a little bit. So it's really weather dependent, and right now we are on schedule.
Fantastic. Also, I enjoyed the visual presentation. I hope we continue with that. Yeah. That speaks volumes of what's been accomplished and the need for that project. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Jeff, for coming here this evening and for you and all your staff. And council members, Councilman Neely, and those that have served on the Caravani Water Authority Board. I can't tell you how excited I am to see this project go forward. I spent a lot of time years ago studying a water pipeline to Genesee County. But your vision, by reaching out to the other communities to the east of us, I think it's really helped make this project go forward. And I want to thank you and all your staff. I know you put a lot of hours and a lot of sleepless nights on this project. I know that. And I can't wait until the first valve gets opened up and we start getting the water in Flint. Thank you.
If I close with just one comment that dovetails on your Councilman Kincaid, he brings up the other communities in the east. Those other communities, ladies and gentlemen, are basically agricultural communities. They grow corn, soybeans, wheat, sugar beets, etc. And the vast majority of what they grow is shipped by train either to Texas or to Canada in a raw form, where it's processed, packaged, and sent back to us. With this water, with the Buick City site, with the talent that we have in this community, Those same agricultural communities, my hope and my goal is that those raw food products will be shipped by truck and train to here, where it's processed into edible food, packaged and distributed. That's our goal. Please don't forget Sanilac and Pierre County were part of this, because they can be the source for that raw food product that we need to make those other facilities happen. So thank you again.
I think I've got two more questions. I've got Councilman Mays and then Councilman Davis.
Real quick, Mr. President, I thank you. And Jeff, I thank you too. You know, some of us looks at the Caravan, they shouldn't be at a stage with Detroit, shouldn't be at a win Caravan, they'd be looking at the quality of wild. You seem to be a wild expert. You know what happened at V8 engine as far as them saying the chlorine and all these details. But what I want you and the public to know is this. We do not set our agenda. When I asked about this special order, Jeff Wright and the Kara Gandhi coming today, I said, how long will it last? They said, about 20 minutes. I never believed that. But nothing to do with you, but we don't set our agenda. And I know we got the firefighters here, we got other people here, and the politics of the emergency manager is after you sit down, then the people got to sit through the capital improvement plan. And I debated it with my colleagues. So what I did on purpose, I said, condolences to you, Mom. Thank you for the presentation. And then I just waited to see who would say what, because I'm charged with being the talker of all talk. So by me saying what I said now, I've made my point. I do appreciate it. I would ask more questions, but when I see people and knowing that, in my opinion, the emergency manager will take my stuff off the agenda. We had something that would have been on the agenda and it ain't there now. I'll talk about it, but my colleagues and others, if I don't squeeze my talk in, it would be just like the puppy. It'll be later on in the night. He'll bend the boys down with presentations. We can't set our agenda. People will be gone and my colleagues will not let me communicate. So I got tricky here, Jeff, to talk to the people. Thank you for the presentation. There's many detailed questions that I would love to ask. Maybe you can come back to Public Works Committee and they can put you on Public Works Committee rather than in the big arena, and we can get into the details of the Kara County. So I politic them, and I say thank you again, and I ask you, Mr. President, can we get into Public Works Committee where I can get into some of the details? I'm just not going to do it here on the floor.
Sure. Councilman Davis.
Okay. Well, I'll ask you some questions that I think the public is really concerned about. We know when we went into this Kara Gandhi deal, we went in with a $300 million bond. We also know that right now Flint only owns 34% of it and the county owns 66% of it. How much is that bond right now as we speak? But also, I want you to clarify or confirm that if Flint is not able to afford that 34% of that bond, then the county would intercept it so that Flint would not go into default. So those are two questions. Am I right about the last question that I just made? And I also want to know, for the public, how much is that bond right now so that we'll know where we at and where is Flint will be able to be at if we're not able to afford that 34% of that bond?
As the very first slide showed you the total of all the construction. It wasn't the 300 plus million, it ended up being a little over 233 million. To date, Kara Gandhi has only borrowed 220 million, not the 300 million, of which Flint is responsible for 34% of. Genesee County is responsible for the remainder.
66.
There is a clause in the bond covenants. Because I look at Flint and Genesee County as one community, not two. There's a clause in the bond covenants that says if Flint cannot make its bond payment that my office, the Water and Waste Services Division, will.
And you are all 100% of it. Flint Blues is their little portion, which at once upon a time, we all 100% of it. So you, okay, I'm listening.
So that's it? Yes. We, the county, the Drain Commissioner's Office, not the general county, picks up if Flint can't handle it.
Thank you very much. I just wanted that to be so the public can understand, because a lot of times the public won't understand it. So I just wanted the public to know that I asked them questions that he confirmed it exactly as I asked. Thank you, Mr. General.
Any other questions? Commissioner Wright, thank you.
My pleasure, thank you.
Next item on our agenda is a special order to allow Megan Hunter to present on the council.
Good evening, council members. So we're just setting up. I did want to acknowledge the hard work of staff in helping to put together, along with our consultants, a draft capital improvement plan, and also the planning commission, in helping to prepare this document, which is what their charter is under the state, Michigan State Enabling Act. Just to give you a real quick, a capital improvement plan is a